All right, and we have we've returned. Sorry for our 2-week vacation. But,
I'm not. It felt great. I mean, I missed everyone, but I mean, it was nice.
Yeah, we kind of went with a little radio silence there. Apologies, but it's just been busy. We've had a lot going on with transitioning JP here, or Japles, as we call him around the studio, into the radio world. So we've just been kind of busy.
How do you feel about that, Japles?
Who, me?
Yeah. No, the other Japles.
No, it feels really, really good. It's great. I'm wearing ties a lot more now. I'm walking up on people being like, I'm on the radio.
Yeah, I wish you wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we're getting complaints.
Yeah. No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Okay. So, but yeah, we've been gone for about 2 weeks. Apologies. We're back. And first off, we're going to try to find a couple of scenarios that Alisa Jett may have left on our last videos.
Yeah,
she
really.
Such really, really cool scenarios there. So we'll read these and reply to a few comments. But then we're going to talk a little pop culture. We hope we have some comic fans in our listening base, because we'll be talking about like the new Walking Dead comic, which was just tragic. Mm-hmm. We'll be talking about The Button.
Yeah, the
Batman Flash. We'll be talking about Invincible, Matt's personal favorite.
It's a good comic book.
And Secret Empire, which is, if you are a comic reader, you've got to get into that.
So we're going
to
have like a comic book theme.
It's going to be, we're going to start off, and we're going to, for our regular listeners who don't read comics, we're going to start off and reply to a few comments. And then, you know, for the ones that want to hear us talk about comics, we'll do that afterwards.
Yeah.
That
way, I hope everyone sticks around, though. It's going to be a lot of fun stuff to talk about.
But that way, if they're not into comics, they don't have to sit through comics before.
Boy, my eyes be itching this morning. Ugh.
So let's start this off with a... Oh, sorry.
I'm worried about JP, his eyes. Yeah. You've been rubbing him a lot. You okay?
I don't know what's going
He's
on.
He's just stoned.
No.
Mm-hmm. He's been smoking Lucifer's lettuce.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. They used to get stoned all the time back in the Bible days.
Oh, I know. For everything.
Like everything. Like a woman. I mean, how amazing is that? You just get stoned. A woman cheated on her husband. Oh, she gets stoned. Well, okay.
That was like the answer to everything.
Right?
I have chicken pox. Stoned.
Yep. You're stoned.
So Lisa Jett left a comment and said, since I do a lot of driving at work, I have a lot of time to think of stuff. I already have 3 more situations that I like. One is where Justin becomes the only thing standing between life and death for a 24-year-old ex-stoner. What a great segue there. With long hair, kid named Joey.
Okay.
He is up against everyone and he can save him. And he will save him. Justin also knows that if this situation plays out, he thinks all of his group would soon follow the young man and all would die. So
he's like a really charismatic, good-looking 24-year-old ex-stoner who wants to lead the group astray?
What made him stop smoking?
That's what I'd like to know.
I guess weed's hard to find in the zombie apocalypse.
If you found weed on a zombie, would you smoke the zombie weed?
Yeah. I mean, if it wasn't like in the zombie's mouth, I mean, if it was sealed up properly.
Let me yoink that out of your mouth. Thank you, sir.
I mean, it's the apocalypse, man. There's lots of things that I don't think I would do now that I probably would just be like, the hell with it, man. I mean, it's the apocalypse, you know.
True story.
I'm trying to get, I kind of got confused reading that. He's up against everyone and can save him, and will he? Oh, okay. So I read that wrong. I said he will save him. Dyslexia. My apologies. Justin also knows that if this situation plays out, he thinks all in his group would soon follow the young man and all would die. Well, then, no, I would not save the man. If I thought that everyone was going to follow him and he was going to ultimately get everyone killed, then in that situation. No. I mean, I think my instinct would be to try to save anyone that I could. But at the same time, if I could see ahead of time and like, okay, I'll tell you what, I will save him because I wish we went back. I don't want to, but if we could podcast in the evenings, I think I would be so much more like, because my mind is still going 100 miles an hour from doing the radio show in the morning.
Let's just kill the stoner. He's an ex-stoner, so he doesn't even have...
Right. Yeah. Right. He doesn't even have any weed.
There's got to be something wrong with him. If he quit smoking, he's probably really like high strung. If he was a stoner for the longest time.
He's in the apocalypse. He probably was a stoner, but he just can't find it anymore.
He didn't quit by choice.
I don't think so.
I'd be eager to learn.
But I guess I would save Joey, but I guess the solution there would be if I'm reading this right. And because normally we print these out, but today is kind of, we were busy in the studio, so I'm reading it off the computer screen, so it's a little bit further away. But so if I'm reading this right, and the thing is, do I save him? But in saving him, I know that people are going to follow him, and he's going to lead to the destruction of our group.
Do you compromise your leadership abilities?
I will save him. You know, I mean, he deserves a chance to live. I'm not going to kill someone over bad leadership qualities. But I will not I won't bring him back. You know what I'm saying? Like, let him go do his own thing. If people follow him that well, then he should have no problem starting up a little group of his own.
That is true.
But the people that I care about and that I've been helping keep alive this entire time, I'm not going to let someone come in and just...
Down there, Negan. All right. I'm not going to let somebody just come in here.
All right. And let's see. I hope I read that right, Alisa. If not, just comment what I got wrong about that and we'll redo that. Another one is that Matt has become almost a star in the zombie apocalypse. Mm-hmm. And Justin and JP watch him start to turn half the mansion into sort of a cat house type thing, and Matt is diving more and more into the dark side.
Okay, so I'm more of a
You're like a Rick James
because you're the cook, man. Of course, people are going to love you. You cook their food.
That is true.
You're like a rock star in this world. I mean, it's either that or like stale rabbit meat, and you're fixing them good food.
I'll make stale rabbit meat the best stale rabbit meat you've ever had. A little bit of cilantro.
It says not in a life or death deal, but they can bring him back to the Matt they know and love.
Okay.
Or wait,
what would you have to do?
So can we? Okay, I don't know why I'm skipping words here. It's because
I didn't type them up. I'm so sorry that I slacked on this.
It's so little. I need to zoom in.
That's
so sorry, Lisa.
That's what she said.
Could we bring Matt back?
Zoom in.
I don't know.
Small penis size.
I don't know. Matt, you're sensitive, so I think if we actually told you, you're being a dick. I think it would hurt your feelings. I think it would wake you up, don't you?
I don't know. I mean, I'm used to it.
Do you think that we would try to bring you back and wouldn't be able to?
I did acting in theater for like 10 years. I'm used to people telling me I'm not good about something.
And you will just... So you're saying you don't think... That's the question. Could we bring you back? She doesn't think... You don't think we could bring you back?
In the zombie apocalypse, no. I think I'd be too far gone. If someone like me is changing, going to the dark side, there's no coming back.
I'd like to know exactly what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Are you just running around the mansion like in a toga?
Well, and Matt has, Matt has said himself he's like our Eugene. So you would be like Eugene. You've gone to the dark side and there's no coming back.
Oh, I don't want to say that, though. Let's hope
so
Eugene
long story
come back.
Short, Lisa, we're going to have to kill him.
Yeah.
Damn it. Absolutely.
Well, fine. No more rabbit.
We won't give the chickens to those people. We'll give Matt to those people. And they can
cannibalize. And then I'd come back later.
Half cannibalized.
That would be like being their leader. That would be a really great episode, like three seasons down.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Like after you forget all about me, I come back into like the end of the next season.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to zoom into this so that I don't misread it again because it's a pain in the butt. All right. So another one. This isn't a lot more serious.
Where does she come up with these?
She said she drives for a living, so she has a lot of time to do to think.
Yeah, what are you going to do, pay attention to the road?
Another more serious one is JP has gotten himself taken by some really twisted and scary people who think that they can rid the world of sinners. And this will take Judith and Justin and Matt. God, I'm still reading it wrong. I need to unhighlight this now. Justin and Matt and perhaps a few other of their people on the road across the country. This is what they want you to do, so you don't know what's in store for you. All you know is that they leave you clues along the way where they're going. This is also when you have to worry about zombies the most, because since you have been in the mansion, you've been pretty safe from them, but now you face them all the time. Number one, if they stole JP, it's not going to be too much longer before they just drop him back off at the doorstep. And they're like, we can't rid this guy of sin. No, they would probably just kill you.
Yeah, I was going to say they're probably going to try to purge me with like dunking me in water and, sticking like bamboo shoots up my toenails.
I could see that scenario. Like I go to Matt and I'm like, dude, they took JP. Woo-hoo. They're trying to rid the world of sinners. How long ago? Probably about a day and a half. Oh, dude, he's dead. They've already killed him. Trying to rid the world of sinners, JP is. It probably died within the first 30 minutes of the capture.
No, JP comes up with all of his captors and we're like, where have you been? He's like, I started a cult.
And JP comes back the leader of that group.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say.
It would be you two versus me. JP would come back with his group. It's funny that JP would be trying to rid the world of sin, though, given his,
But that's, what is his definition of what sinners are?
Right. Basically anyone that does what they don't want.
Mm-hmm.
But JP leading that group, you leading the group of chicken thieves, and then I hope we've got some good soldiers in our ranks, because now
sinners,
it's me versus
chicken
you two.
Thieves and... Whatever your group's called. We've got our
It's like
our
I just
groups.
See Matt. Matt comes up and he's like, I'm going to take, it's like, I'm here to take back what's mine, give him a smack. He's like, dude.
Ow.
God.
I mean,
how would you do that?
I could tell you pulled back a little bit, but still, that, ow.
Jesus, fine, we're going.
You know, the thing about a cult is you have more fun as a follower, but you make more money as a leader.
Yeah.
Little office
throwback. I'm going
throwback.
Back and watching that again. Okay. Yeah, that's why I got a Netflix account this month. That's good.
That's very good.
That's probably what I would miss the most in the zombie apocalypse is watching The Office.
Oh, man, that would be awful.
I'd miss the Netflix and all that. Hulu.
Let's see. We forgot one where Matt was scratched. Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. So Matt's gotten scratched in this scenario. I remember reading
Matt
that.
Scratch fever.
And you were faced with the freaked neighbor. So I guess if I'm remembering right, I'm sorry. I'm kind of keeping it on this one page. But so I guess we've got Matt. Matt's been scratched and some people are freaking out wanting to kill him. Mm-hmm, well, Matt's our boy. So if I'll pull a Rick and Daryl on them, they go to do something to Matt, I'm going to pull R&D. A gun out and be like, we don't kill the living. No, but I mean, Matt's at this point, it's the three of us surviving together. I mean, you've got to help and support each other. If you don't, you're good. So, you know, at the end of the day, if Matt got scratched and we don't know for sure if scratches turn you or not, it may just be the bite. Mm-hmm. I mean, anyone that, you know, goes after Matt's going to.
Turns out it's not even a scratch, it's just a weird 21. Birthmark.
Right, it could have been he fell somewhere, and you know.
Would we immediately amputate though, and then? Yeah, boy,
that's a good question. I feel like
I think it'd be for the best.
JP, I don't know. No, let's go ahead and cut it off.
Nope, cut it off.
Yep. Better safe than sorry.
And then boil the stump. Boil the stump. Always
ultimately,
boil the
ultimately,
stump.
I would look at it in leadership like this. Matt, it's your arm. What do you want to do? Because the thing is if we're talking about walking dead zombies here, I mean, all you have to do is keep an eye on the guy. And if he starts sweating, you can see the signs. It's not like.
Joke's on you. I'm a big guy, so I sweat no matter what.
It's not like they treat it on this like as if you were just walking and talking. Everything's fine. See, that would be a great zombie story to write. Write one where basically, like, there is no. Warning. There are no warnings to it. So basically, you're just here, and bam, you just flip. But, you know, I mean, we know hours ahead of time. So if he does start turning, then we'll have to deal with it. But, I mean, I'd be like, Matt, it's your arm, man. Do you want us to amputate it, or do you want to wait it out and see what happens?
So if I could see J-Pulse being like, oh, he's sweating. I'd be like, no, JP, it's 90 degrees and it's humid outside. I don't know what you want me to do.
Not going to take the chance.
Mm-mm.
Nope.
He's got rings around his eyes. JP, you know he's a recovering crack addict, man.
He's half raccoon.
But yeah,
boil the stump.
As far as amputation, I would ask Matt if that's what you want. If you want the amputation,
very nice to ask me.
I mean, because if you don't and you turn into a zombie, I'm just going to kill you. So, I mean,
what would you like us to do, Matt? I'd like to keep the arm. Well, we're going to go ahead and cut it off anyway. But I just want to check and see what you wanted.
Really was hoping because
I'm a caring leader.
No arm thing.
So funny. I mean, I care. I'm a leader that cares. But
I'm trying to play a diplomatic role here.
I want to leave the arm. Well, we're going to go ahead and cut it off because it's a danger. But at least we know what you wanted.
What Thanks we for making me look like a
is,
dick.
Do you want to keep the arm after we cut it off, or should we just throw it away?
Put it on some ice and
We could save that as bait in case some walkers, you know.
What the hell?
I mean, I'm sure after a while they wouldn't eat it, but I mean, if it's still somewhat fresh for the first few hours, we could use it to deter some walkers.
I'm totally putting that in the next meal because I really put myself into my food. Thank you.
But yeah, no, I would give you a choice because, again, if we're talking Walking Dead zombies, man, you have hours and hours leading up to this. I mean, you get pretty much immobile, but you're still, I mean, we could keep an eye on you. And if that was the case, you know, then we would handle it. But I mean, you know, no, I'm not going to let anyone kill somebody that I'm with, you know, just
you're sweet. Thank you.
You know, yeah, I got your back,
That's
man.
Really nice.
All right. So now Jeep just thinks that we would. Here we are talking about saving Matt. And Jeep thinks that we're going to absolutely just kill each other. She says, you guys are already at each other's throats and the apocalypse hasn't even happened yet.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't imagine you living. Yeah, LOL. I couldn't imagine you living together for any length of time. You would be squabbling with each other constantly. I would have given the people trying to steal the chickens a few of them, maybe some eggs, some seeds, because
being the ever-planning-ahead
person I am, save some for the last year's crop of tomatoes and cucumbers and stuff. Sorry. And send them on their way, telling them that's all they get. Better make the best of it. But see, that's the problem.
Right.
They're not going away
that
easily. It's not that easy.
I can see Jeep being like, that's all you're getting? Like a child is being disciplined.
Right.
That's all you're getting. Don't come
back.
But
the scenario is saying, like, we tried to give them a few chickens already. That was the very first part of it was, you know, give them a few chickens. But they're saying, no, they won't have it. No, yeah, no. If it was that simple, I'd be like, you know, here's. But it's like I said last time.
Thanks, guys. Have a great day.
I do feel bad for them because, you know, it depends on the scenario. Mm-hmm. All right. See, that's the thing, too. We need to paint these scenarios more. Like, A, did they have to sneak past guards and stuff to get these chickens?
At this point, I don't think we have enough guards.
I have less sympathy for them. Now, if they were just coming through the woods and they saw some chickens around in a field, like, I guess we'd have a fence, you know. So I don't know. I mean, again, I don't feel bad for them exactly, but in this scenario, JP being the shoot first, ask questions later kind of person he is, just killed a couple of their people. Mm-hmm. You know, so I mean, I wouldn't mind giving
them some
chickens.
Don't be sneaking up in this time. Like, why?
But we're not giving you all of our chickens.
I mean,
sorry.
Zombie apocalypse aside, if I had chickens in my backyard right now and someone tried to steal them, I would kill them on sight.
You wouldn't like give them a warning?
No.
Like a desktop?
Chicken thieves should be killed.
Okay. All right.
Executed. Murdered.
No.
Dead.
Oh,
wow. Dead.
All right. You hear me? Dead. Well, they escalated quickly from, like, shooting to killing to murdering to assassinating. Did you put assassinate in there?
I didn't, but I should have.
Oh, boy.
I love my chickens.
Okay. Listen, with the chickens, yes, we're not going to give them a lot. I mean, you know, don't get me wrong. I mean, we're not going to let the bullies win, but, I mean, I'll give them a few chickens. But, I mean, if they don't want to leave after that, I guess we'll go to war.
Mm. Over some chicken. How did the, like, Papa, how did the war
start? Dude, it's not over
chickens. Over some chickens, young Joe.
Over food, man.
Over some chickens.
Over food.
Let us tell you the story of the chicken war of 2023.
But, no, we're not really at each other's throat. I mean, we sometimes try to present different sides of arguments.
Shut up, you can't prove that.
Just for the hell of it, because it'd be a pretty boring podcast if every question we're like, yeah.
Okay. Only when we're nuzzling, then we're at each other's throat.
I mean, I didn't mean to ask you about that. Like, no offense, but could you stop that, please? I'm trying to concentrate.
I thought you enjoyed it as much as I did.
Every time you put on those Lisa Frank or Hello Kitty, whatever those headphones are, you just get all sentimental and very emotional and touchy-feely.
Mm. We got some Walking Dead what-ifs, which we should definitely start that back up at some point. But we would be here all day if we started getting back into those. A lot of people really do like the idea of doing the... I say a lot of people. I'm reading one comment.
Mm-hmm. But as we know, one person constitutes 10,000 people on the internet.
They really seem to, you know, enjoy the idea of doing like little episodes. Like we were going to, you know, maybe get with Lisa
or
listeners, you know, and get some scenarios together and then actually have like a audio-only story with sound effects, kind of like
we've
the old days of radio.
We've got plenty of a synopsis, like a bunch of them.
Yeah, so... But there you go. There's our zombie apocalypse talk for the day. Alisa Jet and Jeep, thank you so much for providing us comments to comment on. JP, what are you doing to Matt?
I'm just not comfortable.
I look over and all of a sudden his butt's just right up on me.
I mean, this is the guy that just told us he would be willing to kill people over his chickens.
And
I'm very nervous every time he moves very suddenly.
JP, one minute he's nuzzling, the next minute he's killing people over chickens.
JP he'll kiss you one minute and... kill you the next minute.
That's how
kiss
I get you.
One minute and kiss you the next minute.
So. And kiss you the next minute, and then the next thing you
know.
You
are a very generous, loving soul. It's really great. It's just
HR's involved, just and it's really awkward.
Push it somewhere else. When you said HR...
Wells, yeah.
Anytime someone talks about human resources, I think automatically HR, yeah. Wells. Did you watch the most recent episode?
Yes.
One more to go. Tomorrow night.
I know.
Season
I'm
finale.
So stoked.
The flat. I hope apparently next season, the main villain will not be a speedster.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Pretty excited about that.
Gosh.
Hmm. You haven't watched this season at all.
No, I've told you that 100 times.
That's right.
And then I know now names and things
yeah,
that
but
I didn't
we do
want to know.
I think we do a pretty good job.
Because
they set up the whole season, they set it up in the very first episode about what they're fighting against. And so, I mean, the main villain comes around a little bit later. They switch villains.
Not too much about the Flash. I've not seen that
it's
yet.
It's really crazy
really
when
excited.
Barry spins around the world to go turn time back. In Superman
that's
1.
That's old Superman, yeah. That's just like the biggest cop-out to any
could you imagine thing. Watching that, like, as a person in the 70s or 80s, whenever the first Superman came out, watching that, and at the end of it, he flies around time to speed time back up. Like, how pissed would you be?
I wonder how many people actually believe that time travel worked that way.
Right, if you just spin the world backwards.
Wow, wait a minute. If we just spin backwards, we can go back in time.
That's how they sounded, too.
Yeah.
I want to start using the dumb voices. Man, can you believe it? Like, we could just spin
that. Man.
But I automatically go to, like, Southern every time.
Yeah.
I mean, I've grown up here, so I imagine if I grew up in the North, it would be like, what are you doing? You're crazy. Did you know you could turn back time just by traveling around the earth.
If you grew up in the West, that would have been where the surfer guys went. Whoa, man, you go back
you
in
go.
Time.
How far west are we talking? We're talking about Australia
Superman
there, mate.
And weed, man.
Too far away, right? So, I found a zombie, had some weed in his pocket, so I took it. It's amazing.
It's delicious.
It's delicious.
It wasn't in his mouth.
Yes.
I don't know, I just went almost British there.
The extra care. We've already got like five characters.
Well,
we already did
like all these others. I just figured we had to have a British guy in there
that
somewhere.
Was
wow.
Yeah, I was here on a holiday when the zombie apocalypse.
That's how time travel works.
Mm-hmm. That's really good.
Go backwards. All right. So now we're going to talk comics. So Walking Dead fans, you may still want to stick around. So in the spirit of The Walking Dead, we'll talk about the latest issue of The Walking Dead first. which we know we're a few weeks behind on this, but and then we'll move to the other comics. So at least you get a little bit more Walking Dead. Ooh. If you have not read it yet, which I don't know why you've waited this long to read the newest issue, then spoilers, you've been warned.
And it's been, you said, like 2 weeks, right?
Yeah, it came out the very first week of May.
Even if you read the comic, yeah, you'd have to work really hard to avoid.
Right, on Facebook, right. They're talking about it. So the latest issue of The Walking Dead, Andrea dies.
She's dying the whole issue,
yeah,
too.
And it makes me wonder what's in store for Michonne now, because, you know, they're filling the role of Andrea on the show with Michonne. They've taken a lot of parallels, mm-hmm. like her in the tower, that was Andrea. Her being with Rick, that was Andrea. They've taken a lot of Andrea's storyline, and they're moving Michonne into it. She's kind of becoming the sniper of the group, you know. So mm-hmm. So we know that there was a limit on, you know, Rick's happiness in a relationship. I certainly hope that doesn't mean. I hope we still get Michonne for another few seasons. But yeah, it was one of the most. It was such a sad issue too of a comic. Like, I mean, very few comics mm-hmm. ever make me feel like I could choke up. But if one was going to do it, it would definitely be that one. It was a really heartbreaking issue.
So now of the original group, what is just Rick and Carl, right?
Rick and Carl, to my knowledge.
In the comics?
Yeah, that's it.
Wow.
Everybody, no, Maggie's not the original. You're talking like volume one.
Yeah, like Atlanta.
Yeah, no, I don't think anyone from Atlanta's left except for Rick and Carl.
Yep.
Unless I'm missing someone.
And where are they in the comics now?
Well, they're in Alexandria still, yeah. But Alexandria got overrun. But I think they took care of that, right? Like the overrun.
Well, they're in the midst
of it. They're cleaning up now.
Yeah, now they're more or less facing off with the Saviors.
Yeah, and it's a lot of crazy stuff going on. So Sherry, Dwight's ex, whatever, was leading the Saviors. And basically they came right after the overrun of Alexandria to hit them while they were weak. And take it over. So Rick and Sherry went into a room to talk, and Sherry tried to kill Rick, and Rick just pushed her off of him. And when she did, like Cinderella, what is it, Cinderella, the boxing movie? What was it?
A Million Dollar Baby.
Million Dollar Baby style. She cracks her neck on a table or something and dies. And now, you know, when they came in next, Andrea came in, she's been bit, and Dwight comes in, and we just had a panel of Dwight staring at Rick very angrily, holding Sherry's dead body. So all is not well in the world of The Walking Dead comics.
Yeah, I mean, the big question.
And everything was going so super positive for them, too.
Now it's who's going to lead the Saviors. You got Negan, you got Dwight.
And you've really had, that's why I say if you don't read the comics, number one, you definitely need to. Number two, it's just interesting to see because in the comics, Negan has just made a complete turnaround. I'm not going to say he's for sure. We don't know. You never know what someone like Negan is thinking. But, I mean, it's almost like he's got a hard-on for Rick. Like, he just lives and breathes to impress. And you know, I really feel like they're writing it to the point where, like, you know, Negan, like, sees that Rick's the alpha male, even though
I was going to say, it could be like a man crush. He met his superior.
Right, like, this is the guy that dethroned me. Like, wow, you know, I want to be friends with, not so much I want revenge. I just want to be in with this guy. This dude is, you know, I mean, Rick's not a big guy. He's missing a hand, and he still knows how to unify people and kick ass. So, you know, Negan's done a turnaround. We got some alone time with Rick and Negan in a room while they were being swarmed with walkers. And Negan had plenty of chance. What is it? It was one point where he had a chance to kill Rick. Rick thought he was going to lock him out. And, well, he picked him up too, right? Didn't Rick fall?
Yeah, there's been several.
It's been several instances where Negan could have just easily let Rick die. And he's went back and saved Rick.
And on the same note, Rick saved Negan. Not you know, initially, but Negan was thinning out the herd, and Rick totally could have watched him just get eaten alive.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But Rick saved him with the gun.
And so it makes us wonder, will Negan be back? Which I don't think he will out the gate, but will Rick? Because Maggie doesn't know, or does she? Has she found out that Negan's walking around yet? Because, you know, Maggie's not going to be happy if she finds out Negan and Rick are starting to. Which Rick's not giving him friendship in return, I know, but I mean, still, there's
like
a bond forming there. She didn't until recently,
Negan
at least.
Negan even got to go to Andrea's like deathbed.
Yeah.
Isn't Maggie there by then?
Maybe so. Yeah, well, she came back with Carl, didn't she? Yeah,
that's
her
what
and
I'm
Carl
thinking.
Came back because I think they were standing on the hill.
Yeah, so I'm thinking everyone's on the same page now as far as what's going on.
But so, yeah, it's going to be really interesting. It'd be really cool if they turn that back over to Negan. And let him run the Saviors, but this time you've got more of a reformed Negan because he was twisted and psychotic, but in Negan's own way, things were working. You know what I mean? His people were staying alive until they met Rick and group. You know, I mean, it was a crappy situation, but so maybe now with better, because it's going way back, and I will move on to another comic here in a minute. But going back to the end of All Out War, you know, when he and Rick were talking right before Rick slit his throat, when Rick explained how the trading could have worked and all of that, Negan really seemed like Rick had just opened his eyes. He's like, wow, that really could work.
And at the time, you know, you're just like, oh, yeah, right,
he's
Negan.
Being a sarcastic asshole.
Classic
but now,
Negan. But yeah, now you're like, was he really sincere? Did Rick need to slit his throat?
Yeah.
Probably still.
Yeah. Most likely, yeah, to put him in his place. That was still a great turn. I just remember turning the page, and it was like, and you're like, what the
Ooh-wee.
Hell?
Sweeney but, Todd over here.
I don't know. I it's going to be interesting because now Dwight looks like he might have problems with Rick. You know, I mean, he's not, even though he and Sherry didn't see eye to eye, he still loved her. And now he, to his, Rick told him, he said, she tried to kill me. You know, I didn't mean to, blah, blah, blah. But obviously, Dwight probably doesn't believe
it. His feelings run deep, even though he's got a new squeeze, the tatted up chick with the nose ring. She's all about licking the scar tissue on his face.
Hot. That's
I
Carl.
Assume. I know that
that's
too.
Carl.
Carl's trying to lick scar tissue?
No,
on
Carl's girlfriend is one of the whisperers, and she actually licked his socket. It was really gross.
I assume she still licks Dwight's, like, gnarly face.
Now, is that the...
Just cause the texture.
That's not who got killed, though, right?
It's the texture that gets you.
Huh?
That's not who got killed, though, right? Because we got to
understand... No, his new girlfriend.
Right, but that was Sherry that died, right? Like, former...
Yeah.
You know... Yes, it's The Walking Dead. It's just so many characters, and it's been going for so long sometimes. And they don't really do any coloring or anything. So with it being black and white, it's really cool. But there sometimes has come points where I've gotten characters mixed up because, you know, you don't really have as many things to go by as far as, you know, their looks. You just kind of go by the haircut and the shape of their face. But, so if you're not into The Walking Dead comics, man, the last one, Robert Kirkman wrote a very touching letter at the end of the issue, said that he was on a plane when he wrote that issue. And he was crying like it was, and he thought many times, you know, I could just, you know, before it was published, like, oh, we can change this. But ultimately it had to happen, and explained how hard it is for him to kill these characters, you know, because you've been writing these characters, you're kind of like God to these characters. You decide their fate, you decide what they do in their lives, and then, you know, you take them out. But so really good issue. A lot of build up to it because we didn't really lose anybody big other than Father Gabriel.
Would you guys have rather seen Dwight died in that herd than Andrea if you could have picked one of them?
No, I actually really find myself liking Dwight's character. I mean, I really like Andrea in the show. I could not stand Andrea in the comics was freaking awesome. But I mean, to be honest, I actually because Dwight's kind of followed the same path as Negan. I mean, in a sense of redemption. I mean, he was a bad guy and then started helping Rick, and now is one of Rick's, you know, Rick trusts him.
Did I say Dwight? I meant Eugene.
Eugene.
Andrea got bit saving Eugene. Would you
no,
have rather
No, I would
seen
rather
Eugene
keep
died.
Andrea alive than Eugene. I mean,
so
Eugene's,
you would have let Eugene get eaten alive?
I mean, as far as strategically, I mean, obviously you'd want, she's a badass, but Eugene has so much knowledge and can help get the modern world back on track as far as technology and making bullets and things like that. But I mean, as far as me as a viewer and like the characters that I like, no, I liked Andrea a lot better than I liked Eugene.
And Eugene's made contact with some group, in like Ohio or something weird like that? So,
man, it wouldn't shock me if they end up
Ohio, some weird state like that.
Yeah. Who's ever even heard of
Nebraska or Minnesota, something weird.
No. Who even knows?
But so, yeah, it's really good right now. Andrea, we've lost her. I mean, she had a long run, too. I mean, she's been there since the beginning, and we just finally lost her. Very touching. The entire issue was her dying, more or less. And her words to Rick. And then, like, I really liked how they did it because she gave a speech to Rick. And then at the end, each panel shows part of her speech and shows, like, where, like, these people rely on you and showing people, like, waiting for Rick. And it just was really well written. Another example of why we love the comic so much.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You know, it definitely hasn't lost any substance to the show. At all.
Would you say the same is true for Invincible, Matt? So yes, another Robert Kirkman joint.
I don't read these, so tell us.
Oh, it is another Robert Kirkman joint.
Yeah, another Image title.
Yeah, so everything's still connected together.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's good, man. It's like it takes you back to the golden days of comic books as far as certain characters, and it's more about their personality mixed with their powers rather than picking one or the other. Because nowadays they're like, it's about the people. It's not about the powers. It's about the human relationships. No, this is about like both of them.
Right.
And there's overarching stories where you don't know who's a good guy, who's a bad guy. Mm. And it's also a little bit of coming of age. It's getting ready. It's issue 4 just came out last week. It's got its final 12-issue run. The gentleman that's in charge of it now, like that's doing the writing, the penciling and all that with Robert Kirkman, is the guy that started the comic too.
Oh,
with him. So same guy who started
Walking Dead changed artists after like the first volume or something.
Right? Robert Kirkman, he writes all of these. From what I see, every single issue it says he writes it, but it's really good. Mark Grayson starts off like I don't know how old he is now because his alien race doesn't age or whatever. But it's they deal with like life problems too. Like at one point, his girlfriend is thinking about whether she wants to have an abortion or not, and there's other times where she has a baby, but it's like messes with her body. So like they don't
some real world
right.
Issues
they don't adhere to the
genre,
the image of what a female looks like in a comic book. Like they add some, like when they give her curves and add a little weight onto her, like after her pregnancy and stuff like that.
They do that with Jessica Jones, right. Like her issue, they try to make her look, I think she's very Amy Schumer inspired, but and then on the Defender she looks completely different, but it seems like a lot of really real world issues in the superhero. You talked about abortions. What else was it? You've told me several scenarios.
It's like a father-son relationship with it, because that's a big part of the I don't want to give away too much, but that's a big part of it is the relationship between a father and his son, because the father is this big superhero on Earth, and then the son just gets, because it's hard to give away. It's been going since 2010, I think.
Right.
130 some issues so far. And it really sucks because my buddy had the whole collection, so he gave it to me digital format, and I was able to like binge read all of them in the span of like a month, and now I'm having to wait every 2 weeks.
Yeah, welcome. It's like Netflix when you watch a show and you're loving it, like me with The Flash. I watched the first season, the second, now it's just a whole.
I'm pretty sure they're only coming out like once a month, because I've only got 4 issues so far, and we're in almost the 6th month.
It can be grueling.
Really good. I recommend it. Invincible. Go back and read all of them. Get the. What is it, the print?
He gets Matt's stamp of approval.
Oh, I need one of those.
Get the trade paperback. So
trade paperback.
Because at this point, going back in the issues, you'll pay probably more than you want to, or it'll be hard to do.
And you can always go online and download them like $2, like a dollar less than they would be print issue-wise. And you can end up getting the whole, like a digital format of the whole thing for like $50.
Yeah, check it out. I mean, like I said, it's written by Robert Kirkman. So, if you like he's very, very involved with his characters. A very character-driven stories.
And you will find characters where you'll be like, okay, they got this guy's power set from this character. They modeled this character after this comic character. But it's all original.
It's almost like Ben Burnley had said about when someone asked him, how did he feel if somebody had a song that sounded somewhat like his? He said, well, there's only but so many chords on a guitar. There's only but so many... it's at this point in time, it's hard to come up with characters that are absolutely
completely
unlike anyone else.
Right.
Even you might come up with someone that's just, even a little bit, there's going to be some similarity to someone. It's just really hard not to do that in today's age. So kudos to anyone that could.
And there's like one character called Robot who plays a main role throughout the entire series. And he's like a mixture of Tony Stark and Reed Richards. And a couple you can look at every single character and be like, oh, okay, so this guy is modeled a little bit after Batman, a little bit after Daredevil, because they give them all backstories, really flesh out the characters, really, really awesome. Invincible. I recommend it.
Check it out. Now we're moving on to the button.
Oh boy!
All right, so there. If you're still listening and you don't read comics, number one, awesome. Maybe we can get you into comics. But so they had a 4-issue run crossover between Batman and Flash in this new Rebirth series, which is going to tie into the Watchmen somehow, and it's awesome. It just involves the button that the Jeffrey Dean Morgan, our own Negan, played the comedian in the
film. This is incredible
adaptation.
How everything is just connected,
right? And he had a button, which is what you see whenever you see anything Watchmen, you think of that smiley face button with blood on it. Well, was it Batman that found that? Batman found it first, right, in the issue of Rebirth?
I think so.
Batman found it. And then he and the, I was super excited. I remember telling JP, I got in on Rebirth probably about a week or two after it came out. JP was already reading them and was telling me, man, you need to get on the Rebirth series.
Yeah, perfect jumping on point. Because I fell off during the new 52 years. Like, I started out with it. I kept on the Batman title, but it was just so hit and miss.
I hear that with a lot of people who are just not as fond of the new 52.
And there were just so many unanswered questions from Flashpoint.
That went by really quick. Like, I feel like the new 52 started, and then they were like, we're starting new Rebirth, and I was like, wait, didn't they just do the new 52 recently?
It's 2011.
It had to be done though, man. Just there were many loose strands from Flashpoint, new 52. What happened?
So on JP's recommendation, I jumped on board, and it's been awesome. The Batman title has just been phenomenal. By far the best, I think, of the Rebirths that I read, which I don't read nearly as many as JP. I do All-Star Batman, Batman, Flash, Superman, Action Comics, and that's pretty much it. I flipped through some of the other ones. Suicide Squad I did for a little while.
Yeah, I got that.
Batman, I just think, is amazing.
Oh, yeah. And you know, I didn't think anybody could follow up Scott Snyder's run. He did the new 52 Batman series. But man, Tom King has been, he's been laying it
on
down.
On fire.
Yeah.
Like I said, we had what? We both agreed the Monster Men was probably the only story arc so far in Batman's new run that we were kind of like, yeah, it was just kind of filler. But every other storyline has been touching. There's points where you're like, is Batman about to die? Batman says some deep stuff. There's, I mean, it's I don't want to give anything away, but there's, it's so awesome. Like, you get, it's awesome. Like, it's just been such a good run.
Like, I've been waiting so long for a good Bane story. Yeah. Like, that's what brought me into comics. I walked into the Piney Forest comic shop, and dude's just talking about, yeah, there's going to be this crazy thing in Batman over the summer where this new villain's going to break his back, and there's going to be a new Batman. And I was just like, oh.
Are you sure this wasn't from, like, 30 years ago?
No. It was early 90s, dog.
Yeah, like, that's when Nightfall was, right?
Wait a minute. Is
late
80s,
90s,
early 90s? 30 years ago?
Almost.
Jeez.
25 years ago.
Yeah, it was in the 90s that happened.
Yeah, that happened
like
93. It
sucks because I have to think to myself, okay, so I'm 33, and that was the mid-80s. So then I have to, yeah, so everything just makes you feel old.
Jeez. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was getting ready to say that wasn't from the 70s, but
what
the 70s is
70s,
long.
I know, right? Like, we're almost at 2020. 30 years ago, we'll have been 1990.
I can't cope, man. I can't handle it.
But so what they finally did, and the Flash has had its moments. Like, it's been okay. And Flash has always been, I've said even when I was out of comics and just following cartoons and stuff, had always said I thought the Flash was the coolest hero in the DC universe. I just loved it. But his run on Rebirth has been very hit or miss with me. Like, I like the Godspeed story, but then there are points where, like, with the Rogues, where I was like, oh, man, they wrote these issues following, like, the show. It just wasn't...
I can feel that.
It wasn't that great. But then it's completely changed. The crossover with this Batman has been phenomenal. Mm-hmm. And a little short rundown of the story. I won't give anything away, per se. But basically, Reverse Flash is back, and how we don't even really know, but he's back.
He's a man out of time.
And he has a run-in with someone that creates a mystery that Batman and the Flash have to go on, and it connects us to the Watchmen, and it's awesome. Like,
and you don't, throughout all of it, you don't know. Like, you're just like Batman and the Flash. You don't know who. I mean, they give you a little bit away in the last episode of the Flash issue. But, you're in the mystery, too. You don't know, like, who. You have your suspicions because of the button and all that, but you don't know who he's met, like, what they're talking about, what's going on. Oh, yeah, who set all this into motion.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, man.
It's really good. And at the end, they give you just enough to have you. But you have a character, and I won't tell you who, but you have a character from The Watchmen, and he quotes... So I guess that's kind of a spoiler. It is a he.
It's Rorschach, right?
And he quotes something that he says in the Watchmen graphic, you know, in the actual
comics.
And
it sucks because I had just watched the movie last week. I watched like that 3.5-hour version. And when I read that, I was like, hey, does he say that in the movie?
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, yeah, that's direct text from the comic book. And I was like, oh, cool. So they're making a callback to the comic book.
And see, what's cool is now this is setting up. Matt's disappointment was, you know, they give you just enough to get you and then they stop. But that's comics.
November.
That's what they do. So November, Doomsday Clock comes out. It's going to connect this universe. And somehow the Watchmen, or a particular Watchmen, I think is going to have something to do with missing events and the times.
Now, they showed two Watchmen in the Rebirth launch issue, right? There was two Watchmen in there. I've seen two Watchmen at the end of some issue.
I may have to go reread.
Rebirth or something.
Because I called him super stoked about just seeing the button in the Rebirth first issue, so I think I would have probably shit in my pants.
After we get off of here, I want to search something because maybe I'm
unless
imagining
it was like in the unless it was
else.
Like in the background. But
I'm curious now too.
As excited as we got over this the button issue, I feel like we would have definitely stood out because we both were super stoked because we liked the Watchmen. I feel like we would definitely remember two Watchmen
Fill
showing
in for
up in
a little
an
bit.
Issue.
I'm gonna do some research.
But so the button was really good.
I enjoyed it.
Here's the good thing about it. They came out with so many variant covers that in your local comic book shop, you could probably still go find back issues.
I hate you so bad for that. I literally would have went along with the regular issues, but you're like, go
they
ahead.
They have these cool holographic.
Get the hard case and the holographic. Go ahead and buy that other issue again.
But your wall's
I've never bought
look
the
so
same
sweet.
Issue of a magazine, comic book, anything twice.
Yeah.
And until I met you.
Well, I'm going to tell you, your collection is going to look that much sweeter, though.
I'll believe it.
Like, all four on the wall. But no, I mean, but the good thing is, if you want to get into that, it's pretty self-explanatory, too. I mean, they do a really good job of calling back, letting you know what's going on. Go to your local comic book shop. It's Batman and Flash issues 21 and 21 and 22 and 22, I think, is the order it goes. So basically, it's Batman 21, Flash 21, Batman 22, Flash 22. And, I mean, it's really good. Like, a really good four-issue run. It's got me excited about, you know, comics, you know.
In just two more months, man, we got the War of what? Riddles and Jokes coming up in Batman?
Yeah, man. You're going to have the Joker and the Riddler battling for the right to take on Batman,
yep.
Right?
That's how it seems.
The Joker and the Riddler?
Yeah, they're going to be going head-to-head. Joker.
Right?
I mean, don't get me wrong. I think the Riddler's smarter, but the Joker just always seems to come out on top of his plans. I don't know how.
It's going to be interesting.
He's like the Master Chief of villains. He's just got good luck. Just things work his way. I don't know. But so that was really good. Now let's talk Secret Empire, moving from DC to Marvel.
Ooh-wee.
Man, what a good title this one's been so far. You said, JP, that you think that this is probably going to be one of the best encompassing stories since the first Civil War.
Yeah, for my money, I think it's the coolest thing I've read, like crossover wise, since World War Hulk.
That's your favorite,
that's
right?
My favorite.
World War
yeah.
Hulk would be your favorite, like
Marvel
like wide
big,
event.
Yeah.
And so this has been really good, though. I mean, like, and we've had some really cool plot twists.
Mm-hmm.
And this one, I don't want to spoil it, but man, it's so hard not to.
Yeah, I mean, how can we not talk about it?
So we're going to talk about this. So we try not to spoil the button just because with a four-issue run, I mean, you could just run to your local comic shop, grab those four issues, and be done with it.
I think I read it's going to be 10 issues all in all, either 9 or
Secret
10.
Secret Empire?
Yeah, they expanded it.
Nice, because, you know, which I hope they don't. It doesn't end up being, because we've gotten three issues here in the last month. We got Zero, Free Comic Book Day, four. We got
four if you count
one
free
and
comic
two.
Book day.
Yeah. Whereas the Civil War II just kind of drug out there towards the end.
That always makes me a little nervous when they say they're adding on issues, because that may mean they don't know how they're going to wrap it up. They're doing rewrites. You never really know. But I hope that's not the case. Nick Spencer, he seems like a top notch writer. He's done really. I mean. Just his Captain America run leading up until this has been killer.
Yeah, oh yeah. Steve Rogers has been. And now you read both Captain. Does he do both Captain America titles?
Yeah.
And you read the Sam Wilson one as well, right? I don't read. And you like that? You said that's
pretty
good.
Yeah. Sam Wilson's basically like a social justice, I think that's the term, like hero. And he's, you know, fighting for the oppressed. And I mean, there's definitely a lot of like political kind of undertones, which I don't always appreciate.
Right.
You know,
just
I'm not trying
comics.
To watch. Yeah.
I mean, like, I'll get into politics when I get into politics. But, I just want comics.
But, I mean, that being said, it's really well written. I mean, I can't complain at all. It's not like anything's being shoved, you know, into my mouth and down my throat. You know, nothing like that's going on. It
that
digests really well. Mouth rape, anyway.
All right. So, it's been really good. So, all right, now we try not to spoil, but this one we've just got to. So, if you've not read Secret Empire up to this point, tune away or what you have to do. But, anyways, so what's really cool is the whole story of Secret Empire. And if you don't read comics and you're still tuned in, hey, thank you.
Boil the stump.
Captain America, man. He's had his memory wiped or rewritten.
Rewritten, yeah, by sentient cosmic cube who took the form of a little girl.
And thinks that he is Hydra's top agent, you know, and it's basically now taken over the entire country, and it's under Hydra rule, and Captain America is the supreme leader, pretty much.
And what was really cool to me is issue zero, he basically reveals himself to be the supreme leader. You know, he's doing all this nefarious stuff. Then we get to issue one, and like the war's over. There was no war. Like, he is in charge now.
He's a great strategist, man.
It's like, not some long, drawn out thing where, will Cap win? What's going to happen? No, he like straight up took over America.
And then the Free Comic Book Day issue was really cool because that kind of showed you some of the battles that you missed, just showing how quickly and how easily they defeated these heroes that you think would fend off. I mean, Cap is a great strategist. I mean, he's got... And so it really throws us for a loop here. So you've got all this going on, and you've got a resistance made up of, like, Black Widow, Hawkeye, and some of the Marvel champions. But then, at the very end of issue two...
Well, can we go back to Free Comic Book Day for just a second?
Yes.
Cap picks up Thor's hammer.
Yeah.
Like at the
very
end.
Right, I didn't even think about that. Yeah.
Like all the heroes fall just like snap your fingers. I mean, he does them all in, and then he picks up Thor's hammer.
Yeah. And I mean, so, but you've got to be worthy to pick that up, right? So apparently, is he doing the right thing? I mean.
I think in his head, like, you know, he's doing the right thing, and he's so.
He's got a pure heart in the sense of he thinks he's doing what the world needs.
Didn't the Hulk pick it up at one point in the comic books?
No, I don't. There was a big deal. All right, when we were watching the Avengers, now this is taking you back to 2012. When we were watching the Avengers in theater, because I remember one of the storylines, when Thor and the Hulk, and I've got like three friends that'll back me up on this, when they were fighting in the hangar or whatever, and Thor dropped his hammer, I was like, Hulk's gonna pick it up. He's gonna try to pick it up, but he can't. You know, because there was a cartoon they had of one of the comics where that happens, where he knocks Thor down, and he goes to pick up the hammer, but Hulk can't actually get the hammer up to display to you that, you know, how heavy it is.
So nowhere in the comics, I thought he picked it up at some point.
But there's been so many. The thing with comics, though, man, is there's not one concrete storyline. There's so many offshoots that it very well could have happened at some point.
I remember the Red Hulk, who was Thunderbolt Ross. Mm-hmm. He didn't necessarily pick it up, but he grabbed it and just, like, rode its momentum and could, like, guide it. So it was sort of weird. But, I mean, so much
But, like, I do know that there was one particular storyline where when the Hulk's gone crazy and all of the Avengers are fighting him, trying to stop him, and in that storyline he tries to pick up the hammer, but he can't budge it. And then that's, you know, while he's distracted, they continue to kick his ass. But I remember that from, like, the cartoon, and when we were watching it on screen, I was like, oh, man, the Hulk's going to try to pick up the hammer. He's going to try to pick up the hammer. And then he did, and I was like, yes, just because it was just so random. I don't know why. It was not the same scenario. It was not the same setting, but it just, that scene reminded me of that from way back. But yeah, he did pick up the hammer. So now let's see, is there anything in between 0 and 2 that we should discuss before the big whammy that they hit us with?
Basically just all the heroes are, you have a small resistance, like you said. What you got, Black Widow, you got
Marvel
some of the
champions, like the kids, right? Isn't that what they call them?
Yeah, Tony Stark, the AI version.
We think he's the AI. He looked pretty solid the last time we saw him.
Yeah.
Because you know that sometimes the storylines going on haven't caught up. Like, for instance, and again, if you haven't, Civil War 2, sorry, there's going to be spoilers here. That happened last summer. War Machine was still alive in the comics, but had died now in that. So they had jumped a little ahead. So maybe there's a way Tony, I don't know. It's confusing, but he does like to talk about him being drunk and things like that. I mean, it's.
Yeah, but on the title page where it lists all the characters is Tony Stark parentheses AI.
Does it say that? Yeah, I hadn't seen that. It's just, it's really confusing because they talk about, I don't want to hear another one of your drunk rants. And it's like, but if he's the AI.
I think he's like programming like some kind of simulator. I don't know, something wacky, but.
But so Tony Stark, but see, remember when we were, and another thing too, remember in the prelude to Secret Empire when he and Riri were like repairing the stuff or whatever, like we thought straight up that was AI Tony Stark in the Iron Man suit.
Yeah.
But then like the little square slits, you see what looks to be like a person behind it, like skin and everything. So it's. I don't know. I mean, I guess they're just saying it's a really good AI. Mm-hmm. But, man, it gets confusing when you're reading. The main thing is the bubble. The bubble they make jagged, like computer speak.
Yeah.
But anyway, so it's like, you got the resistance of that. I'm trying to think if there's anybody else in there we've left out. A lot of New York superheroes are stuck in New York.
Yeah, in some dark dimension or something like that. Doctor Strange, Daredevil, all like the street-level New York heroes.
I'm disappointed we haven't seen much of Peter Parker's Spider-Man. Yes, they put him on the cover of issue one, and I was super excited thinking that, because he really didn't have that big of a part of Civil War.
Yeah, I hate when they do that.
And I thought, like, okay, maybe he'll be, you know, that's my favorite of all the heroes. So I'm like, okay, well, maybe he'll have a big part in this one. And
yeah, Miles Morales Spider-Man's really playing more of a part than
they're really kind of weeding Peter Parker out of like the group scene, more of like he's doing great in his own issues, but they're really kind of moving him out from when it comes like a big group event. But and Miles is,
as far as the like the remaining heroes, basically there's a schism. Is that a word? That's a word, right?
Schism.
But schism, you got Black Widow and all the champion, like the younger heroes. They're basically going off to assassinate Steve Rogers, whereas you've got, what, Tony Stark and whoever else, like, going to try to find the, put together the Cosmic Cube.
Because Tony Stark, because what's his face?
Rick Jones sent them the intel, like, look, this is how they rewrote his memory, yada, yada, yada.
I'm Rick Jones, bitch.
Yeah.
And he ended right before he got the firing squad. Yep. But yeah, you're right. And then, so Tony Stark saying like, "Hey, if we can go find these fragments,
we can reassemble."
Because I guess he's kind of along the lines of, "It's Steve. You know, this is our friend. This would be like if Matt went evil and we figured out that he wasn't in control.
It wasn't his fault. Yeah.
We would be you can't go kill him. We're gonna change him back. I mean, you know. And whereas Black Widow's doing what she's programmed to do, to take out the threat. And now you got Miles Morales and some of the champions are with her. Miles Morales, going back to Civil War II, had that vision of him with Cap's body on the Capitol steps.
And now it finally makes sense to him. He's like, okay, well,
I've
got to
be the one to kill him.
So, and the champions, they're just so tight. They're like, we're holding down Miles over
wherever
here.
Wherever he goes, we go.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really cool that they've got that big of a bond. I mean, you got, like, what, Miss Marvel and...
You got the new Miss Marvel, like the... you got Amadeus Cho is the Hulk. Yeah. Yeah, totally awesome Hulk. Viv, the Vision's daughter. I think Nova.
Nova, yeah.
I know, like, young Cyclops is in the Champions, but I don't know if I've seen him.
Yeah, I don't know if I remember seeing him going with them or not.
He's probably with the mutants up in, what, like, Northern California, wherever they're posted up.
Mm-hmm. And so it's really cool. You've got all your heroes kind of divided, you know, and that was the divide and conquer, right? Like, you kind of split, you know, got the heroes and stuck in. Then you've got poor Captain Marvel, and all of the other ones are stuck in outer space.
Yep.
And who was the girl that got killed by the Chitauri thing, like, it ate her or whatever? She was, I mean, she wasn't somebody that I read a lot of, but
I can't remember what,
but
she
had,
was
like
the new warlock or something. I don't know, she was
as far as we know, she's been eaten by a giant.
You
know, she's probably just drowning in digestive fluids right now.
Delicious.
Slow, painful death.
Yeah.
But yeah, so Secret Empire, now getting to the end of issue two, because, man, it just was such a kick. And I got to read that and the end of The Button in the same day. Mm-hmm. So it was like, what a great day to be reading comics. But at the very end of issue two, you find this woman in the woods.
Under attack by the Serpent Society.
And out comes this man, which, I mean, he saves her or whatever. Out steps this rugged, manly-looking guy that says, my name's Steve Rogers, and I'm just trying, you know, I'm trying to get home. I'm lost. I'm trying to get home. And you're like, what? This is more confusing than when Clark Kent was with Superman.
How
is there a Clark Kent and a Superman? Mm. Which ended up just being Mexoplex, and I thought was a huge cop-out. But anyways, we're not talking
about
action
comics.
Hopefully
that's not,
but,
what happens here. I hope not.
But, dude, that was just such a great way to end that issue. I mean, I love it. Like, I don't feel like I got that, man, at the end of any of the Civil War II issues. You know, I mean, it had some points where it was like, oh, dude, but...
But yeah, possibilities. A different Steve Rogers, not evil.
Right.
He has a beard. Could be Ultimate Cap from the Ultimate Universe.
Right.
End of Secret Wars, the Ultimate Universe. Just for some reason, there were some survivors that are like in the main Marvel U, but as far as the rest of it, it's just kind of...
Miles Morales is from
Miles Morales. Apparently Wolverine's son from Ultimate Marvel. Mm-hmm. He's just going into one of the new X-Men titles. I mean, you assume, like, I guess the Ultimate Marvel Universe just kind of gets put back in its place or whatever, but they never really address it.
I just hope they're not going to kill main Cap and be like, but it's okay, we have another Cap who's just like him. It's like, man,
but I've
give
read
me a cool story.
Nick Spencer's been saying that is like the Captain America. It's not like a time travel thing.
Talking about in the Steve Rogers storyline.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
That is
It's not like
Cap,
interdimensional, so I'm really curious. I know, like, Steve Rogers was stuck in Dimension Z for a while.
Right.
I don't know if, like, maybe, like, he got split in two, or if the Cosmic Cube girl split.
It could be. I mean, maybe they'll explain it away as if, like, I couldn't just get rid of his regular side, so I had to divide them in two. And what you have is the rewritten Steve Rogers, and then you have...
I hope it's not super convoluted, but...
I have a feeling it probably will be.
Yeah.
But...
Like time remnant Steve Rogers.
Right. I hope they do. I mean, but it was a really great twist. If they can pull it off, like I said, because it was a great twist in Action Comics when you see Superman and out comes this Clark Kent, and Superman runs all his tests, like he can tell his heartbeat, and he's like, he's not lying. He thinks he's Clark Kent, but he's not me.
Yeah.
And then it ended up being a big cop-out, and you're like, wow, that sucks. But so if they don't go that route and they actually do keep you, you know, I mean, it really could be a great storyline.
I hope.
But so, yeah, what other comics did we? Was that it? Was there any more?
Matt, did you finish your research? What did it turn up?
So it was apparently the last few issues. At the end of Rebirth number one, it's like the last page of Watchmen or something. And because I don't want to give away too much for what we were talking about earlier, but there's a callback to Watchmen in Rebirth number one.
No, they had a callback, but did they show?
Yeah, it's like the last page or something.
I've got to go back and look
at those. I do too, man.
That's what I just found on there.
Darn.
Huh. It's like right after Wally says someone's watching us.
Man.
Wally's in the Batcave. Batman finds the button, and Wally says someone's watching us.
And they show, man, I totally spaced on that.
I'm going to cut the mic real quick. Okay.
Yeah, they took the last page of the Watchmen and put it in.
Now that makes sense.
Epilogue.
Yeah, I thought you meant that there were two Watchmen in, like, we saw them in Batman's world. I feel you now. Yeah, they took Yeah, no, that was straight up from the Watchmen comics. Yeah. They just threw that at the end.
And like this is Owlman 1, right? This is who we're talking about.
Okay, so I thought that...
I still don't remember that, though.
I remember that. Yeah. I was thinking, I don't know why, he was saying, like, they showed them in, like, Batman's world. And I was gonna be like, how did I freaking miss that? No, yeah, I remember that. Yeah, that was at the end of it.
Some rereading.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, because I was like, what? But yeah, so great, great, great story. Get the button. It's 4-issue run. You can, if you don't really get into comics, maybe you just kind of delve a little bit. That's mm-hmm. a great run to get, and then you can jump on board for the Doomsday Clock, mm-hmm. which comes out in November, and you'll have an idea of what's going on.
And it's kind of its own standalone story. Like, you don't need to follow any of the Flash before this or any of the Batman.
At this point in life, everyone knows who Batman is. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows who the Flash is. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can jump on that. So
Iris doesn't
do really
know.
Good. Iris doesn't know.
That Barry is the Flash. In the comic books.
Oh, yeah, no. I was about to say, did you spoil the show for me again? Like, did they rewrite her memory?
That's so funny.
Because last
dude.
I saw, she knew.
Barry just keeps putting his dick in the timeline, keep messing everything up.
It feels so good, though.
That's my. I just wish they'd get away from, like, the time thing. It's just very convoluted and very. There's so many. Well, why wouldn't you? If you know that this is going to happen in, you know, whatever, 24 hours or however much. Why don't you just alter the plan? Like, why don't you do something different than what you would do? It's just a lot of that, especially in the last episode. With Captain Cold and all that. It's just like, why would you do this? Why wouldn't you do that? If you know this is going to happen in the future, then don't wear that shirt.
Right.
And maybe that'll change the timeline. Who knows?
Yeah, it's
don't wear your murder outfit on the day that you're going to get murdered.
Oh, I'm so stoked for tomorrow.
I know. I'm looking forward to how they're going to wrap it up, and I'm looking forward to what they're going to do as far as teasing next season.
Justin, we might have to plug your ear holes and just talk about it Wednesday morning. We may have no other choice.
Come over to the office. You come over to my studio. We'll close the door.
I mean, there are phones. No, you can just like call or text each other.
I'm going to be busting.
What you don't realize is I can hear everything.
Oh,
the other morning,
no.
I was in there putting gel in my hair, and y'all were talking, and I was in there while putting gel in my hair going, la, 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 la.
Stop putting gel in your hair so quietly. I don't know what to tell you. Be loud like normal people.
But so let's see. I think that's all the comics we wanted to cover, right?
I think so, yeah. That's the ones I'm the most stoked for.
If you don't read comics and you stayed all the way to the end of this, awesome.
Proud of you.
Thank you.
The code word is boil the stump.
Boil the stump.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But, so some awesome stuff. We've been talking for a while about doing Walking Dead comic casts, like just each Wednesday after we read it, just coming in here, sitting down, doing like a little 5-10-minute podcast, just kind of review the issue and maybe eventually get into doing comics as a whole. JP has a lot of different
comics.
Titles. I have a lot of different titles. There's things I read JP doesn't, things JP reads. Very few things, but things JP reads few things that I read that JP doesn't. JP's box is just...
It's a full-blown
It hurts
addiction.
My wallet.
You know,
JP's got a full box.
When I go to JP, we go with JP to the comic shop, and she pulls my little stack out, and I'm going through what I want to get and what I want to leave, and then she pulls JP's stack out and actually has to get the forklift out of the back. It makes my wallet hurt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But so, JP's, it's very few, but there are some things I'm reading that JP isn't.
Yeah, Jessica Jones.
Yeah, which you are getting into the Defenders. So.
I'm picking that up.
After Death AD, you have, but you haven't read
it
yet.
Haven't read it yet.
Gotta read that, man.
I need
ended
to.
Very good. Remind me after, I'll tell y'all something kind of sad about that.
Uh-oh.
So we got some good titles to work with. So if any comic readers are out there listening, give us some feedback. Let us know if you want to start hearing some comic casts. We'd love to do it. Love to do it, and especially with Invincible ending, Matt could do something really awesome
so
with that, like
that.
You know, a grand finale.
That's
kind
something
of
I've wanted to read for forever, but
dude,
just
get into
never,
it. It's amazing.
I haven't taken the time. I'm going to.
Well, I'll see if I can get you the collection.
I would like that very much.
Mm-hmm. We will see you next week. We took a little 2 weeks off; just been busy, but we will see you next week. If you leave us some more scenarios in the comment section, I'll tell you what. Too one thing is
now you do know next week's Memorial Day weekend, right?
You will not see us. Mm-hmm. No, you will see us, but it'll be on Tuesday.
That's fine.
Or Wednesday.
Yeah,
it'll
say.
Be one day that week. I might take off Tuesday. We're planning on having a cookout, and I think I'm going to take out
a boil or what a steam out.
We're going to have we're going to actually instead of cooking out, we're going to actually
crab legs, shrimp. Oh my God, I'm so excited!
Be amazing
corn of the cob, potatoes. What else in there?
All in one steamy pot. I don't know. Maybe some seasoning.
There's something else they throw in there that I'm forgetting. The mushrooms. Not mushrooms. I got potatoes, corn. And there's something else people throw in there all the time. I forget. Maybe like onions or something. I don't know.
Yeah, I could see that.
Peppers and onions, I guess.
I mean, when you cook onions, you really can't go wrong.
You can't, unless you're allergic to them.
JP doesn't like onions.
I'm not a big fan.
So we've got to be careful.
Oh, never mind. I know there's something wrong with you.
You like potatoes
exactly
and corn, though, right?
What's wrong with you?
What, the onions? I don't like the noise they make in my mouth.
Oh, like the squeak?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I mean, if it's like grilled onions or sautéed, I mean, I can handle them. But
so you just don't like eating an onion?
I don't
like
eat
an
raw
apple.
Onions, I can tell you that. Like, yeah. I don't like hot dogs and stuff.
I love it all. I love onions any way, shape, or form.
But if you leave us some more scenarios, I'll tell you what, too, because the thing is, I really think that a quality of those could be a lot better. But we're doing this kind of like on our lunch break podcasting, and so I'm always kind of rushed. And, you know, but if we had time to actually sit and look at these and then think on it, we could probably give you some pretty cool answers.
Mm-hmm.
But so, yeah, if you got any more scenarios, put them in the comments section and we'll go from there. But
we'll
see you next week at some point. I'm Justin.
Hey, I'm Matt.
And I'm JP.
At some point. That's really nice.